Every year, the most accomplished scientists in the world get their hair cut at the beginning of October, just in case they receive a very special phone call from Sweden. It's what some of them have been waiting for their whole lives, the Nobel Prize. But there's a lesser known award that the team has always loved here at SciShow, the Ig Nobel Prize. Instead of recognizing the world's most important research, the Ig Nobel celebrates the weirdest. And quite a few Ig Nobels have gone to scientists studying weird things about our favorite subject, ourselves. So here are 10 of the greatest Ig Nobels ever awarded for research on the world's strangest animal, humans. One of the weirdest things about people is how our beards only cover a specific part of our faces. Like, they could just as easily go over the bridge of our noses too, but that's more of an AI version of a beard, you know? One made by a computer that has no idea, just inspired nightmares across the world. No, beards pretty much stay along the jawline, and the study published in 2020 might explain why. The authors of that publication placed a sheepskin over the top of an epoxy material designed to simulate bone. Then, they dropped a weight on that fake face to see if it would break under impact. As you might expect, it did, pretty much every single time. But then, they covered some of the fake face in wool, simulating a beard, and the fake bone only broke about half of the time. That led these researchers to theorize that we have beards covering our chins to protect them when we fight. After all, the bone under your beard is one of the most likely to break during a scuffle. It might even work the same way a Kevlar bulletproof vest does, by distributing the force of a blow over a larger surface area. When they calculated how much energy was absorbed by the wool versus sheared skin, the wool came out ahead by 37%. So we might have beards over our chins specifically to take a punch. And if you feel like it takes a lot of self-control to not punch some unbearded people in the face, this next Ig Nobel Prize has a life hack for you. Apparently, one way to control your urges is with pee. Researchers in the Netherlands and Norway learned that if you're willing to risk the urinary tract infection, holding in your pee has all sorts of benefits. They asked university students, the guinea pigs of humanity, to do a water taste test. This was, of course, a ruse to fill their bladders. Some of them were instructed to drink all of the water, while others were told to just sip it. Then, the scientists had them do some busy work to build up the urgency to pee. Once they had spent sufficient time sitting around full of excess water, they were asked to do some financial planning. As it turns out, the participants who drank all of the water and really had to suppress the urge to pee were the ones who could suppress the urge for instant gratification of other kinds, because those individuals were willing to wait longer for a larger payout on the financial questionnaire. Meanwhile, the participants who just sipped the water tended to choose the immediate, smaller payout. It seems kind of unbelievable that urination urgency is related to financial planning, but these researchers think that the stop signals in your brain that keep you from emptying your bladder activate the stop signals that keep you from making short-sighted decisions about money. Now, finally getting to the restroom after holding it in for too long feels incredible, but nothing compares to the feeling studied by our next Ig Nobel winner, scratching an itch. Sometimes, you have a very itchy spot that you really shouldn't scratch, like, you know you'll just end up doing more damage to your skin than good. But it's so itchy, you have to do something! Well, researchers in Germany figured out another weird thing about people that might help out in that situation. But to test itch relief, they first had to make people itchy. So they injected histamines into one arm of each study participant. Then, they placed a mirror between that person's left and right arms. When the participant looked into the mirror, it reflected the image of one of their arms. So basically, they could see two arms in front of them, but it was really just one arm and its reflection. Essentially, the person could look into the mirror and get the impression that everything that was happening to the non-itchy arm, for example, looked like it was happening to the itchy arm. And in one of the creepier but harmless research protocols, the scientists then stroked the participants' arms to help them scratch the itch. The thing is, they didn't always scratch the itchy arm. They found that sometimes scratching the non-itchy arm also worked to relieve the itch. I mean, it didn't work as well as scratching the one that was actually itchy, but having an image of the non-itchy arm being scratched seemed to be enough to provide some relief. I guess we're more malleable than we think. Speaking of which, you know those clickers used to train dogs, where you tell the dog to sit, and when they sit, you press a button to make a clicking sound that they associate with a treat? People can be trained that way too. And that's not to say anything about our intelligence, because the study that won the Ig Nobel Prize used clickers to train surgeons, who you'd Hope are pretty smart people. The authors of the study trained a group of medical students to tie a knot and drill a hole using dog training clickers. And the students who learned with clickers completed those tasks more precisely than other students. Like, all 12 of the clicker-trained students performed each step of the task as shown, while only 4 of the traditionally taught students did. It's basic operant conditioning to learn not-so-basic skills. And apparently, there's still a lot to learn about our most basic behaviors, because thanks to the next prize, we know that you have even more to gain from sex than you thought. When your nose feels a little stuffy, maybe you need an orgasm. A study published in 2021 reported on the nasal decongestant effects of orgasms in 18 couples. They were operating on the honor system because, well, yeah. So each participant assessed their own nasal breathing right before sex, immediately after sex, and then after 30 minutes, 1 hour, and 3 hours. They also checked in at the same time intervals after using a nasal decongestant spray that you'd get at the pharmacy. And the results were, they're equally effective. An orgasm clears out your nose just as well as drugs. Now, the nasal decongestant does last longer, so if you opt for the natural routes, you'd need to be up for multiple rounds of treatment. But the orgasm effects last for about an hour, which is pretty impressive. It could be thanks to that exercise you just put in, or it could be some kind of interplay between your sympathetic and parasympathetic systems that get activated when you orgasm. Either way, your nose clears up. And that's quite a feat because there's a lot of stuff in there. Even just the large number of nose hairs is something to contend with. That's why this next Ig Nobel winner was such a heroic undertaking.
Thank you for supporting SciShow. Thank you for being a part of this incredible community in the comments section. Thank you for telling your friends and enemies about SciShow, and thank you for enjoying the 2025 Complexly calendars that we've made for you. And that's right, I said Complexly calendars because they're really about bringing together all of the Complexly shows in one super cool piece of merch. That means we're showcasing Crash Course, Eons, Bizarre Beasts, Study Hall, and your favorite SciShow channels. The theme is a quarter century of progress, so each month celebrates something from the last 25 years that gives us hope about how far we've come and just how many possibilities lay ahead. Like, one month we're celebrating mRNA vaccines, and another is all about expeditions aboard the International Space Station, but I won't spoil all of them for you. In this calendar, you also get beautiful wall art, courtesy of the incredible Emily Alvarez. Now, we're only making a limited number of these, so get them while you can at complexly.store/calendar or the link in the description. Every purchase of a Complexly calendar supports the SciShow team. So again, thank you for your support.
I'll just come out and say it. You've been living in your body now for how many years and you still don't know how many nose hairs you have? It wasn't until 2021 that anybody bothered to count. And yes, they really did remove and count each nose hair in 20 cadavers. Thank goodness they did, because now we know that we have about 100 hairs per nostril. Yes, it's statistically the same in the left and right nostrils, and in different sexes. And sure, maybe there were more pressing scientific questions that kept us from getting to the bottom of this question until now, but with your nose hairs as part of your first line of defense against sickness, this wasn't as silly of an investigation as it sounds. And just because your nose hairs are symmetrical doesn't mean that everything on your body is. I mean, the left and right side of the scrotum are different temperatures. Yeah, I kind of gave away the punchline before we got into the research, didn't I? But this finding is weird enough that you should stick around for the ride. Researchers in France measured men's scrotum temperature every 2 minutes for 2 hours under a few different conditions. They tested bus drivers and postal workers in their peak reproducing years, naked and clothed, and during their workday in different positions like sitting, standing, and walking. And they found that at least when clothed, the left ball is hotter than the right one across the board. Now, they're still within range of each other, so it's not like the left side is 10 degrees warmer, but they're pretty consistently brothers, not twins. The authors of this study think that the left side is warmer because of the angle of the dangle. Okay, so they didn't say it like that, but 89% of the time that a man is wearing clothes, the penis rests on the left testicle, so it might be an extra blanket of warmth that the right side doesn't get. And again, this is a weird finding. Maybe the study itself is even weirder. But scrotum temperature is a big factor in fertility, so this research matters to a lot of people trying to grow their families. And that journey often starts with finding the person that you want to have a family with. The next Ig Nobel Prize goes to a weird way you can tell you found the one. Maybe you're on a first date and feel that click when you realize that you like the same movies or were both your grandma's favorite grandchild. Whatever it is, you definitely feel connected. That might be because your heart rates have synced up. In a study published in the journal Nature, scientists were trying to figure out what's behind that feeling. So they had participants on blind dates hooked up to heart rate monitors and wearing spy glasses that tracked where they were looking. You know, normal date attire. From all of that tech, they found a correlation between attraction and how synchronized the couple's heart rates were with each other. They didn't see that correlation in the other metrics they assessed, like where the couples were looking during the dates, which are more consciously controlled. So heart rate might be a reflection of the natural way someone puts you at ease or gets you excited with their own feelings. And this might be the force that makes you want to go on another date. In these researchers' previous studies, they found that it's a good predictor for trust and cooperation. It's the kind of thing that often syncs up the longer you've been with your partner, the greater satisfaction you have with each other, and the better you become at reading each other's emotions. So when you're sussing out if you should spend more of your time with someone, listen to your heart. Or just look at their eyebrows. Eyebrows might not be the key to finding everlasting love, but apparently, they could help you steer clear of narcissists. In a Canadian study, researchers gave participants a test called the Narcissistic Personality Inventory that measures how egotistical, self-focused, and vain a person is. With those scores in hand, the scientists then took their pictures. And they used those photos to try to figure out what makes a person identifiably narcissistic, just from looking at them. First, they asked a different set of participants to judge who looked narcissistic when given an image of either just the top or bottom half of the face. Based on those scores, the top half of the face was the winner. So additional judges came to look at individual features on the faces, like the eyes and eyebrows, and those results pointed to the eyebrows being the defining characteristic. In the end, all it took for these participants to identify a narcissist was a single eyebrow. And when they put the eyebrows of non-narcissistic people onto the faces of narcissistic people, they were rated as less narcissistic. And that's weird. Like, eyebrows don't seem more important than your mouth, but they are super expressive, so that's probably why they matter so much. The authors of this publication said it might be because they're higher contrast than some other parts of your face, but that would depend on your coloring. The main idea is that more distinct eyebrows are associated with narcissism. Now, should you go around judging people based on their eyebrows? No. Hey, buddy. My eyes are down here. After all, the point is that how we read faces is unexpected and more complicated than we thought, let alone trying to read someone's psychology. But as weird as that Ig Nobel winner is, this last one will probably raise even more eyebrows. When you're walking somewhere and see someone stopped, looking up at a window in a nearby building, you might look up too, even if there's nothing special about that window. A group of researchers wanted to know how many people need to be looking up at that window for you to stop and join them. They started out with one person looking up. As people passed by, 42% of them looked up as well, and 4% stopped what they were doing entirely to stand with that person and look together. So now there are two people staring at a window. In that case, the number of people who also looked up jumps to 60%. And by the time there's a group of five people looking at the window, 80% of passerby will look too. So as the initial crowd gets bigger, so do the chances that a person will look up to see what in the world is going on. The authors of the study call it contagious. But how contagious it is depends on whether you just look or if you completely stop walking to gawk. The graph of people who look at the window without missing a step toward their original destination is an inverse exponential curve. A lot of people will do that even if the crowd is small, and the number grows a bit as the crowd grows. In comparison, the graph of people who stop what they're doing to join the crowd basically looks like a straight line. For this much commitment from a stranger, you generally need a larger crowd. The number of people who stop to join the crowd is always smaller than the number of people who keep going. More people join the crowd, more people join the crowd. So yeah, we're incredibly weird. Enough to justify a science prize completely dedicated to weirdness. I, for one, hope the Ig Nobel Prizes only get stranger from here. And SciShow will let you know when they do, because SciShow video editor Seth Glicksman also serves on the Ig Nobel Board of Governors. Whenever a scientist publishes something wonderfully bizarre, you'll see it.